Woke you up to get back on your job, amen? You need to be representing. Come on, let's do a song. Because you know this thing is not about us. It's all about the Lord. That's what the whole book is about. It's about Him, not us. And as soon as you know it, you get flowing in.
The nations will see it.
The nations will see it.
The glory. creation, reveal your majesty. From the dust of the ground, by the works of your hands, you formed us to man. After your image, your power is second to none. Your throne is established, and it's everlasting. Your golden majesty. Let the God, let the God of creation be praised. Let the God of creation be praised. Let the heavens rejoice.
Let the heavens rejoice for He reigns.
Let the heavens
rejoice for He reigns.
Lift your
voice with the praise
to the King. Lift your voice with the praise to the King. Blow the trumpets in Zion.
Blow the trumpet in Zion.
Mighty is He, singing, oh,
what a wonder.
Yes, the nations will see it.
The nations will see
Your glory.
Worship You, Lord, this morning. We just thank You, God. We thank You, Father. We give You the glory this morning. You deserve our worship. You deserve our praise, God, because You are mighty and You are great. And You are worthy to be praised. And we thank You for what You've done, what You're doing. Yes.
Lord, bless You. And keep You, make
His face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Let's declare amen. Thank you for your favor. Just thank you, Lord.
May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations for your family and your children, their children.
We declare
their
that.
Children. May His favor be upon you.
Because our Father, our Savior, is in it. He's everywhere.
And a thousand generations for your family, your children. Their children and their children.
May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations in your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations in your family and your children and their children. May His presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, He is with you in the morning, in the evening,
Heavenly Father, we know in this moment you are for us. And Father, your word says, if you be for us, man, what can stand against us? So Father, right now, we turn it over to you. Let this praise be sweet aroma in your nostrils, Lord. It is all about you. Have your way in this entire place, Father. Meet people right where they are. Allow the Holy Spirit to move in this moment, Father. We worship you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Give him praise because he's worthy this morning. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, Lord, we love you this morning. Amen, 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 amen. Have a seat. Make yourself comfortable. Welcome to the Blended Church. It's good to have you in the house this morning. I want to go ahead and release any of our fifth and sixth graders. Miss Carrie, Mark's way better half, is waiting for you up in the balcony. Pastor Mark is blessed beyond measure. We are so happy about all the teachers who are teaching this morning, man, all the volunteers who are that came in early and prepared, because it's all about showing Jesus to even that next generation. Hallelujah. So thank you, all you teachers. Thank you. I want to say hello to all of our guests. If you are a guest in the house this morning, you are welcome here. This is a church of a second chance. You may have been coming, you may come in them doors wondering, can anybody give me another chance? I'm here to tell you, yes, Jesus can, and he will. He'll meet you right where you are. So welcome, please, if you could, stop in at our welcome desk, check in, let us know that you joined us this morning. We have a gift for you. It includes Pastor Danner's book, The Blended Church. We give those out free, and we've been giving them out free for years. My goodness. So praise God. It's only through God that we can continue to bless those that come into the house. Let's prepare ourselves to give unto the Lord. How about we give with a cheerful heart this morning? Just real quick, the thing that hit me this morning was, his favor is going to be upon you for generations and generations and generations. But you know what? That starts right now. That starts in everything that we do. Man, parents, we got to model this, not only to our children, but those around us. When we say we're all in here at the Blended Church, that means we are all in. Why? Because it's a lasting impact for generations. For generations, we want this thing to outlast us. So when you give today, just understand that God is looking to run you over with blessing. But he wants your heart. He wants you to understand that his plan is way bigger than anything that we could ever imagine. We get to be a part of it. Amen? Amen. Give in that spirit this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. We honor you. Father, you've taken care of us more. My goodness, we are in the palm of your hand, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the increase that came in. We thank you for the breath that we give to praise you this morning. So, Father, I do ask that you bless the gift and the giver as it comes in. May it do the work that you've deemed it to do, Father, around the world. Lord, touch and move in such a way that somebody hears the name of Jesus today, because the Blended Church is standing together. We thank you and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. I also want to welcome everybody that is online. If you are tuning in, streaming, we still have seats. But boy, I tell you, it's filling up. It's good to see people coming into the house. We're doing it in a safe way. Amen. But we understand some of you are still connecting with us online, and that's okay. There's ways to give through our website and through our Text to Give app and the different things available to you. So feel free to utilize those. I'm going to cover a few of the announcements, and then I'm going to get out of the way because I'm excited about the message today. Let's start it off. As always, Pastor Mark is looking for more volunteers. If you are called to bless some of our children and men, I'm pointing at you as well. We need more men to model in front of our young men, and that's in our children's church. But we are looking for more volunteers to come on and join the crew. Our TBC marriage group, they're actually meeting here. They alternate between here and their location and going back and forth. Tonight is going to be here at 5 o'clock. So couples, married couples, come on out. There's an opportunity for you to join. Another opportunity for couples. Well, I'm telling you, we are ministering to couples now more than ever, and it's important that we do. Crystal and Augie are holding Wednesday, October 21st. 7 p.m. right here. Dinner is provided, so come on out. They do a carpool, and they get together, and it's really, really a great time. Sunday Rewind, Pastor Rodney has shared many times. That group is phenomenal. They do it online and in person right here in the church. So come on out, learn more about diving deeper into what is shared. And now you probably want to make sure you're there this Wednesday because the word is going to be good today, but you want to dive deeper. Pastor Rodney does a great job doing that on Wednesdays. Tonight is step four. We are adding people to our dream team tonight in the journey. Yeah, I'm excited about that. We have a great group. So some people are excited about stepping into ministry this Sunday tonight. If you missed step four, it is not too late. Come on out, 5 o'clock. I'll be here ready for you. Men's breakfast. Man, I'm really pumped about this. I'm going to be there. The elders, some of the elders are going to be with us. Guys, come on out. Now is the time to get activated. We always talk about next steps here. Your next step is waiting on you, and we are going to rally together. We're going to have a great time at that breakfast on the 24th. There's going to be a night of worship. I'm excited about that, Pastor Jeremy. And I think Kimmy is planning some great things on October 30th, another night of worship here. And then last but not least, we've been telling you about Trunk or Treat. With all of these things, sign up. If you're gonna have a trunk involved, Pastor Mark asked me to have you sign up out in a foyer. You can also sign up for the men's breakfast. So all the sign-up sheets are out there. But still, you can donate candy as well on the 31st. All right. With that, let's welcome our pastor, Pastor Daner. Nope, not on yet.
Check, check. There we go. Hallelujah. I'm sorry you have to listen to me. I have a two quick things. I appreciate Pastor Rodney last week. I left Rodney in a very difficult position where we're at in this book. And Rodney, I appreciate you. And I'm going to use one. Rodney had given me an example. I thought he was going to use it last week. He didn't use it, so I'm going to use it. So I'm going to hack one of his ideas. I would love for you to pray about an opportunity we have. I've been sharing with you, many of you know, Sarah, who was one of our Bible smugglers in Iran for a year. She was put in prison. You guys know the story. I've heard of Sarah. She's a hero to me. Her husband, Samuel, they live in Turkey, Istanbul, Turkey. They pastor a church in Istanbul. We send money in there quite often, and we have an opportunity with a TBN studio years ago. That's the quality of it. Whether you like TBN or not, just get over that issue. But it was a TBN studio. They do quality. It's in Istanbul, and we've been offered studio time in Istanbul to program a show that will go into every Farsi-speaking nation in the world. That would be Iran. That would be a little bit of Afghanistan. So if you go study the language of Farsi, and look, I just ask you to pray about it. It's going to be a huge opportunity. There's nobody that needs to needs the gospel more there than in the gospel of Iran. So just pray with us over that. What we would do is actually, they offered us some time, and I said, well, I know a preacher that can do it.
Yeah, amen.
And she could speak the language. She was a Muslim. She came to Christianity, and she is a powerhouse speaker. And so Sarah committed to doing it if we raise the finances to do it. So just pray with us over that. And then I would like to say, it was my son's birthday yesterday. It's good to see you here, John. I love you. But my wife back there in the checkered mask, we have tolerated each other for 35 years. I just want to say I love you, girl. God blessed us. You know, he's an amazing God. He jumped down in the middle of our life 35 years ago, drug addicts, wild as all get out, crazy. She never even believed in God. I'd be drunk arguing if God was real or not. But God saved us and touched us. And I just want you to know, this is how you make a marriage last, is when you focus on Jesus first. And when you put Jesus first. And you know the cool thing is about it? I'd marry her all over again. That's how awesome that she is. And I appreciate her. And I'm going to do something. Today is going to be, oh, help me, Jesus. I apologize. We've been in this for 13 weeks. I never thought I'd be here. I've been waiting 13 weeks to put this chart together for you. I've stressed out my daughter today. I don't know where she's at, but I put her through a lot of putting this chart together. This chart's not going to make sense to you when you first look at it, but if you will give me a chance, here's the deal. We're at a place of revelation where it's going to get really fun. We're not going to walk verse by verse through 13 through 18. We're going to do a cool series on heaven. We're going to, and I promise you, this is going to be fun. We're going to spend a couple weeks on judgment, white throne judgment, millennial reign, and on the eternal reign of Christ. Many of you know Rodney did such a great job last week sharing you the book of Revelation is not something to be scared of. The fact of the matter is it's really an answer to your prayer and to my prayer. Because we prayed, God, get me out of this mess again. I'll never ask. Just get us out of this mess. Yeah. Get us out of coronavirus, all this racism stuff going on. Get us out of this whole world's done gone crazy. Come on, how many thinks the world's gone crazy? Everybody got their hand up. Get us out of this mess. That's what the book of Revelation is doing. God's making everything right and finishing it. He's bringing justification. He's making it all right. It's all settled. The score's settled, and he does it right. He comes on the throne and fixes it all. With that said, I'm going to bring us a place we are going to get done with this book. I'm excited about the Heaven series. My attempt today will be to explain what's going on in my head this morning, and that's a scary thought. That's a very scary thought. If you know me well, that's a scary thought. What's very scary is like this book has set me on fire. Many of the staff will tell you I've been consumed and growing and learning. And if I've been walking with the Lord for over 35 years and been a student of the Word, and I'm still learning, that means you can still learn and you can still grow, catch a new fire and a new hunger. I'm going to circle the wagons today. I'm going to bring us back to a place. I'm going to attempt to try to allow you to understand this book maybe in a new way. Again, I'm not worried about if you believe what I believe in it. I just want you to have a grasp on it and understand some of the things. There's some rules in this book. Number one, every prophecy is near and far. That means this. Many times the prophecies were fulfilled then, and many times they have futuristic things that will be fulfilled. What we're going to read in Revelation 12 today briefly is really, you could say, was fulfilled in Genesis 3. True. But I'll show you some passages that also show you it's for the future generations also. Yeah. Revelation 13, talking about the one world government. You can actually interpret it and say, well, Nero and the Romans fulfilled this part of Scripture, and that's true. But I can also show you a few parts of there, a few little nuggets that shows you it has to be futuristic also. That's how powerful the Word of God is. Actually, today, as we walk through Revelation 12 briefly, you're going to see that there's really, you could do clearly three interpretations of what that means. And what you mean three ways to look at it? Yeah, and I believe they're all true. That's how big God is.
Yeah, amen.
He's so amazing. He's bigger than our understanding, bigger than our, so near and far, remember that. Remember that. So when anybody argues with you over the book of Revelation, you just got to realize it's deeper than any one of us, one person can go. Deeper than where we can go. Number two, the rule in the book, this book is not monochronic. That means this book doesn't fit along your Western chronological mindset. That means chapter one does not necessarily mean it's before chapter two in the book of Revelation. And I know that's hard for you to understand, but that's your Western mindset. This book was not written to a Western mindset people. And I know I repeat this, and I'll quit repeating this when you catch this today. But this book is different. You're actually going to see that, and I'm going to give you some examples, just because it's the next chapter. See, listen, when John wrote it down, he didn't say chapter 12 and write it down, and chapter 13 and write it down. He didn't write it down like that. There were no numbers involved. Wrote what he's seen. And the view was polychronic. That means the view was like this. It's floating. It's moving. There are pictures in and out. It's different views. You're going to see him have a view, and you may see him have a different glimpse of a different view later on. So you've got to be careful not to just say, well, chapter 12 now it has to move to chapter 13, it has to move to chapter 14. You're going to way misunderstand the book. I've attempted to put a chart together to help you do that. Listen, to this book, to really understand this book, number one, you've got to see it. You can't just read it. You got to feel it. You got to feel this book. Amen. You can't read this book and just say, no, I'm just going to sit down and read a chapter a day and get it. I mean, you're going to have to feel it. You're going to have to really say, Holy Spirit, help me. You're going to have to hear it. It's filled full of signs. It's filled full of sounds. It's filled full of explosions and lightnings and thunderings. It's filled full of dramatic stuff. He just doesn't say there's a dragon. He says, it's a great dragon. He adds emphasis to it and brings it out. He makes it alive. It's not scary. You're going to have to see it. You're going to have to see it from a placement and from a position. And I know that sounds goofy. From a placement, you have to understand who you are in Christ to really understand this book. Amen. Let me give you the depth of this book and why I dread teaching this on a Sunday morning. Because you really have to be spiritually discerned to understand this book. It's like a parable. When Jesus spoke parables to many people, they were like, oh, that doesn't make sense. They weren't supposed to understand it because they weren't spiritually minded. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and Jonathan, let's just skip to verse 4 if we can do that, or verse 5, and we'll just start. And just listen to what Paul writes here. 1 Corinthians, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 2, or I'm sorry, Jonathan, I wrote down, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and this is my fault. How many know I usually blame Jonathan for something? Today's my fault. I take the heat this morning. As Robin said, we have broad shoulders working in the church. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we'll just find that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. So don't look at me or like I'm some great revelator. Just ask the Holy Spirit for wisdom, all right? Verse 6. However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature. This morning, what I speak is for the mature believer. Here's why it's very important, because you don't even know how to act during the racism issue right now. You don't act to know how, in the political scene right now. You don't know how to act in the coronavirus right now. And if you're acting like a nut now, I can't even imagine what kind of a nut you're going to be then. And you better learn how to handle this, because you think the world's rough right now, baby. It's going to get more rough. And you're going to have to learn how to control your Facebook and shut your mouth when you don't have all the wisdom, instead of spewing your philosophy out that you only got a half-baked wisdom. And sometimes you got to learn to just keep your mouth shut. And we're learning as Christians. Hello. However, we speak the wisdom of God in a no, go back to verse 6 for me, please, Jonathan. Thank you for keeping it moving. But we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not in the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. That's where our political stuff's going, coming to nothing. Verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom of God ordained before the ages. The time. Now listen to this. If the book of Revelation was just meant for everybody to understand, then Nero would have understood it, Caligula would have understood it, and they would have destroyed Israel. They would have known how. Babylon society, if they could have understood. Listen, if you could, but regardless, if governments understood the book of Revelation, they would know how to manipulate the future. But it wasn't given for normal wisdom. It's spiritual wisdom discerned by a mature believer. That's why you don't send a new baby Christian to read the book of Revelation. And the very first thing they say, well, I've read the book of Revelation. Well, it's the worst place you could have started. Forget that, shut that up, and go back to John. You're going to have some spirit. Listen, that's why some people aren't coming back to church right now, because I'm teaching this, because they don't understand. But the truth is, they don't have the maturity to catch a hold of it right now. And I don't mean that demeaning, not in any way at all. But you have to grow to be able to really catch this book. Hidden wisdom of God ordained before the ages for our glory. Verse 8, which of the rulers of this age, for if they would have known, they'd have never crucified the Lord of glory. If the devil would have realized, they'd never put Jesus on the cross. Hello? Some government moves are the worst move they could have ever made. And see if they would have. So, you're catching it. Verse 9. But it is written, eyes not seen nor ear heard have entered the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. The key is the next verse. But God has revealed them to us through his, not through your great reading, not through your great understanding. See, even no matter how well I teach, really, I can't make you comprehend this. It's really got to be the Holy Spirit that will catch something in you. I mean, the craziness this book is, you understand, I've read this book in probably 20 different translations. I've read this book in complete Greek. And I mean, I've read it from the Syntychus or Sinaiticus, which is really from Sinai, and the translation they found one of the complete in the third century translations. It was the whole translation in Greek. I mean, I've studied through that and looked at it and seen it, and through many different Greek, I've read it in so many different ways, but yet I still read it last week and seen some, whoa, I never seen that before. How is that? Because the Holy Spirit just clicks the lights on. Amen. Like, woohoo! I'm calling Damon, man, do you know this?
Yeah. Amen.
He's like, I thought you read it before. I've never seen that. That's how cool it is, right? And God just keeps speaking to you, and he does it for me, he'll do it for you. You don't have to have a title of pastor or anything. He'll give you wisdom. Through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, and the deep things of God. Verse 11. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of a man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Notice what he's dividing the spiritual from the natural. Next verse. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit is from God, that we may know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things to spiritual things. That's where it's at this morning. You're going to have to catch this in the spirit. In the natural, you'll never get it. It's not in human wisdom, but it's in spiritual wisdom and understanding. You all right? You okay? For time's sake, we'll just leave the rest, Jonathan. Rodney came up with this idea a few weeks ago about understanding this book as I was working through this outline. I've called many pastors and shared this outline with. I've called a lot of people on staff here. I would talk to my daughter through it, talk to my wife about it, talk to Jeremy about it, Rodney about it. This outline, because it's not monochronic, it's not chronological Western time frame, is so different. You've got to grasp this in this thing. It matters where you view the book from, how you read the book. It matters where you're at when you look at the book. Remember I said it's a matter of being where your perspective, where your perspective is how you see the book. The example that Rodney gave, and Rodney always uses these examples, Damon can confirm this, is football. And no matter what you talk about, Rodney will always come back to a football example. Always. And we begin to discuss, well, the book of Revelation is like watching a football game. You know, the question is where do you watch the football game from? As a matter of fact, put the pictures up for me, if you will, Jonathan. I just threw up some pictures. You know, it's one thing to view the football game from that. Now, look at that. You can see the whole field, but can I tell you, you'll never know if he was out of bounds. Right? I mean, sometimes from that view, you can see the dude's open. Why didn't you throw it? You forgot. The dude's only 5'11 and can't see over the 6'6 guy he's trying to throw. He can't see the guys open. It's still the same football game you watch. And by the way, who's a Cowboys fan here? Anybody? I see somebody back there. Let's go on. Or how about if you watch the football from that view? A little bit different. You could say, I'm sitting on the 50-yard line. Yeah, but you can't even tell what the guy's expressions was. You can't hear anything that's going on the field. So how many knows it's a different view? Same football game, but you probably tell a different story. See, what you got to understand, John's going to be in different positions viewing the vision. And he sees the same thing, but just a different view. And sometimes God brings you back, brings John back to this story and says, well, let me show you this from a different view. And all of a sudden, John says, whoop, I was in heaven. Whoop, I was on earth. Whoop, there was an angel. Whoop, there was. And he's getting the same view of the same game, just a different view. By the way, I have no 49er stadium up here. I'm sorry. Let's go on. How many knows that view is a little bit different? How many knows you're always wishing they were on this side of the football field when you're sitting in seats like that? You ever sit there like that? Yeah, we all have. It's hard to tell if they scored. Did they cross the goal line on the other side? I don't know. You're looking for a TV, a different perspective, even though you're at the game. Go on, next view. Boy, that's the coach's view. 50-yard line right there, but he can't see squat. They're saying, throw the flag, he's out of bounds. He's like, somebody tell me on my earpiece, because I can't see that line over there. I don't know if he's out of bounds or not. Was there interference? What happened in that play? Throw the flag. Look at the next view. Woo. Look at that, Damon. How about those Bears? How many knows that view looks a little bit different when you're standing in the end zone? Right? Let's go on, the next view. You ever notice some coaches don't even stand on the field because can't coach well? They sit up in a coach's box. Not only do they have a field view, but it's so far back, they have a TV right in front of them. They've got two perspectives to really coach well. It used to be unheard of to see a coordinator, an offensive coordinator or a defensive coordinator, not be on the field, but now they're all up in boxes. Because they all realize this is a better view. What I'm trying to do with the book of Revelation this morning is give you a different view. Or look at the next view. I watched the game. Who's, yeah, I don't know what happened. I don't know who scored, but somebody scored. I heard the noise. I seen the fireworks. Boy, it was crowded in there. People were socially distanced. Yeah, you could see there. So it matters how you see. Now let me tell you something. God lets John see the book of Revelation from all these views. Let me say it again, and I hope you're catching this. He's allowing John to see it from all these views. Actually, the book is not that long. But he recapitulates the story over and over. Let me give you the definition of the word recapitulate. And I had to look it up to find the right word a few weeks ago. So that's not a word I use. The word recapitulate means to retell the story with different highlights. To retell the story with different highlights. Like, for instance, you may hear about a basketball game that Mark Damer and I played. But Mark will tell you he got fouled. Let me recapitulate this story. He never got fouled. He traveled and pushed off. The word recapitulate means to give in a new form of expression. To give in a new form of expression. You got to remember, when John's telling the story, he has emotions. Can you imagine the emotions he must have been feeling and like the stirring inside of him? And one minute he's happy, one minute he's sad, one minute he's like, I don't even know what that means. What is that? I don't even know. And the Holy Spirit said, right, John, right. Yeah. Okay. Right? I gave you an outline today, and you're going to need the outline. If you don't have one, if you would lift your hand, there is a outline that was placed before you. When you first look at this outline, you're going to freak out and say, this is craziness. I know this is what's in my head. I'm sorry. I apologize. If you're really going to understand, just lift your hand and they'll bring you one. If everybody just lifts your hand, they'll bring you one. Listen to me and look at me while you got your hand lifted. Even some of our staff over here. And my favorite drummer over here, he needs one too. All right, y'all with me? Look at me. Before you look at the outline, listen to me. Revelation chapter 1 is the revelation of Jesus, what the book around. Revelation chapter 2, Revelation chapter 3 is a story of the churches. Probably in Revelation 4, something happens with the church. I don't care if you believe the rapture or not, whatever. That really doesn't matter, but something takes place. Listen to me very close. Revelation chapter 4 to Revelation chapter 11 to the end of the chapter is the end of the book. I know that freaks you out. Revelation chapter 4 to Revelation 11 is the whole 7 years of tribulation. And actually, it starts from the very first day judgment starts until the return of Christ. And see, you thought you were going to go on read chapter 12 and wonder why you got confused. Now, hear me out. And I don't. If you're not going to buy this, that's okay. I'm not worried about it, but it'll make sense to you. When you start Revelation chapter 12, actually, John goes from being in heaven and now he's standing on the earth and has a whole new view. And actually, it starts chapter 4 all over again, just from a different view. Just from a different view. One time, Paul's on earth in chapter 4, and he sees the rapture of the church. Revelation chapter 12, Paul's in heaven, and he sees the rapture of the church. Just a different view, same story. Recapitulates it, gives us a different view. See, some of you go from Revelation 16 to 17, you don't realize he's going to recapitulate some stories that already took place. He's just going to give you a different highlight from a different perspective. He's going to go to the coach's box. He's going to go to an aerial view. He's going to go to a field view. And when you start seeing some things like this, it won't read word for word, but when you start catching, all of a sudden the lights will come on, like, oh, wow. So Revelation chapter 12 through Revelation 16, 17 through 21 is basically the same thing that 4 through 11 were. Just a different view, a different perspective. When you get to Revelation chapter 17, you're going to get a view of the spiritual destruction of Babylon. Babylon is the one world government. Babylon is the trinity of the devil, the Antichrist, the beast. The devil, all the authority of everything from the pits of hell, fighting and causing one world government. Let me tell you what you're voting for most, and most of you don't even really realize this. Your real issue of voting is one world government, my friend. Most of you haven't paid attention to that. That's what you ought to really pay attention to. Because when that happens, all hell's breaking loose. There are a few issues that are on the political agenda now that really have to do with one world government, a place that a people have to believe before that one world government can come to pass. See, there's going to come an Antichrist on the scene. And he's going to be ushered in like somebody you've never seen before. And when it happens, there's got to be a one world government in place. As a matter of fact, that's what he's all about. But it has to have him to a place where he can even start that movement before that happens. You'll see the one, and we'll talk about that at a later time. The spiritual destruction of Babylon. In Revelation chapter 18, you're going to see a material or a physical destruction of Babylon. It's the same story. You just see it from a spiritual view in Revelation 17, and you see it from a material or from a possession view. You see it from a worldly view in Revelation chapter 18. The same, the chapters are the same, it's a different view. The same things. Well, you say, well, don't have the same words. Well, you got to read spiritually through the thing. In Revelation chapter 19, verses 1 through 9, or 1 through 10, actually, 1 through 9, 1 through 10, give us the scripture of what it's like, the battle, or what heaven's like when the war's won. But yet, then in verse 11, he goes right back to Armageddon again and gives us a review of 17 and 18 that we just went through. And actually, 15 and chapter 11. We just went through. He's given us another view, but now he's going to give us a heaven perspective, a kingdom view. This is going to take a lot of study from you, and I can't do this for you, and I'm not going to do it. So you're going to have to catch this as you read through the book. Can I be honest with you? This has been years and years and years of study, and now, like, I've been consumed for the past month walking through this thing trying to bring it out. I would tell Damon over and over and over, man, it's repeated pictures. But you're going to have to work through this if you want to work through it. You all right? I hope I've not freaked you out so bad you don't run out of here and say, Pastor Daner's lost it. I lost it a long time ago, so. He's going to fill the details in. He's going to recapitulate the story so you can understand. Like, say, let's just do, can we do Revelation 11, 15 through 19? What I'm telling you is when John is on the earth, he sees the end of the world from a heavenly view. Watch this. Let me say this. Everything ends with the seventh trumpet. Everything ends with the seventh trumpet. The vials are in the seven trumpets. The bowls are in the seven trumpets. The woes are in the seventh trumpet. Time takes place through the seven trumpets, but the seventh trumpet is a simultaneous event that opens up the floodgates and everything happens then. It's the end. I'm not saying that when the seventh trumpet opens, it happens that day. It may take multiple days. I don't know how many days it takes. But it takes time. But it's one event that unleashes everything else. Everything in this book is about the scroll that had the seven seals on it. And nobody could open the scroll because it was sealed. And remember, one man stood up and said, the angel said, he can open it. And Jesus took the scroll and heaven partied. And through the next seven seals, Jesus would open every seal. And when the seventh seal was opened, remember, the angel stood on the earth and the sea and said, whoa, yeah. The book's been opened, baby, and he's taken over.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
And the kingdoms now are all his. You say, Jesus died, he bought it back. True, but we still have a spiritual battle going on. You're still fighting with the devil. Hello? And if you're not fighting with the devil, you better come up here and preach, because I'm still fighting with the devil. And it's all in that seventh seal. Watch this verse. And the seventh angel sounded, there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Heaven's rejoicing. John is in heaven, and he sees the seventh seal and the people in heaven, because it's over with, baby. Verse 16. And the 24 elders sat before God on the thrones and fell on their faces and worshiped God. Why? Because it's over with. God's finished the job. Look at the next verse. Saying, we give thanks, O Lord God Almighty, the one who was and is to come, because you've taken great power and reigned. Verse 18. The nations were angry and your wrath has come. The time of the dead that they should be judged, that you should reign. What's he telling you now? Now's the judgment. Now's the nations are done. Now's he's on the throne. It's over with. Yeah. Yeah. Can you catch it? People are being judged. Rewards are being given to the prophets, the servants, those who fear your name, small and great, and you should destroy those who walk on the earth. It's finished. The next verse. Then the temple of God was opened up in heaven. John's in heaven, but now he sees the temple. What's it a view of? Our eternity. That's going to be the focus throughout all of eternity, is this temple. That's where every eye turns. Go to Revelation chapter 19, verse 1. Watch the same view, the same scene from a different view. After these things, I heard a loud voice, a multitude in heaven saying, notice, he's on earth and he's hearing sounds from heaven. Watch, I love this. Alleluia, salvation, glory, and honor, power belong to the Lord our God. For true righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication and avenged her blood on his servant shed by her. See, remember the people crying out, God, when will you fix it? He just answered your prayer. God, when will you make it right? That person lied about me. He just made it right. When will you expose? He just made it right.
Thank you, Lord.
Let's go on. Verse 3. Again they said, Hallelujah, smoke rises forever and ever, talking about Babylon. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God. Remember, remember the last view we just had of them. They fall before the throne, who sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. Verse 5. Then a voice came from the throne. Remember what we've seen of you. Praise our God, all you servants and those who fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, a voice of a great multitude, the sound of many waters as a sound of many thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord our God omnipotent reigns. He's taken over. It's the same scene, just a different view. Yes, sir. What are they shouting about? It's over. Amen. Thank God it's over. I mean, my prayer is every day, the more I watch news, like, God, please come back quickly and get this stuff off. Stop this craziness. Verse 7. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and the wife has made herself. This is a great event, and we'll talk about that later. And I got to keep my mouth shut that I don't jump into this because I love this. Verse 8. And to her was granted a raiment in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. He said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. What happens is the next verse, as it starts moving on, he's going to go give you one more last view from a kingdom view of the Battle of Armageddon. See, and that's why you get all confused, like, what the heck? That's why you got to catch this book in a different view. I pray you'll go back through this chart, study it, look through it, rethink through the book, pray. Listen to me. When you read it, you got to pray. You need the Holy Spirit's wisdom. You need to pray in the Holy Ghost. You need the Holy Ghost to give you wisdom and understanding. Pray through this thing. Read through this thing. Catch the thing. Listen to a dramatic view of it. If you go on YouTube, you can put in your car. How many of you have drive time back and forth to work? Put in YouTube the dramatic events or just the book of Revelation in a dramatic view. They'll play sounds out for you while you listen to it. You'd be surprised what the lightnings and thunders and the voices and the waters you hear will do to you as you hear it and what it will bring to you. You okay? Pastor Rodney, look at me and say, are we okay? Something I need to review there. Get rid of your chapters. Are you with me? Get rid of your chapters. They were there so they could make sense of the documents. They were never there. They're actually not there anywhere. 1 Corinthians 2. See, and we divide them. You think 1 Corinthians 3 is different than 1 Corinthians 2. No, there's not. Just because it's a new chapter, they didn't write it in there. The translators wrote the chapters in there so they could put it in order. Are you with me? Actually, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, sometimes in books runs together. And there's no division in the Greek at all. And we're thinking, well, it's different. Well, not really. It's just the way we do it in our monochronic, chronological time view. Are you okay with me? I'm going to quit using those views. I'm done using those things. I pray you catch this morning. Amen. Let me give you some little nuggets before I close. Some fun stuff that I like. Revelation chapter 12. I'm gonna throw something out. Rodney mentioned, but I wanna touch on it because it's like a favorite of mine. Revelation chapter 12. I'm sorry, Jonathan. I don't know what the heck I'm doing. Revelation chapter 12. Now a great sign appeared in heaven. We're moving on. Again, I'm telling you, this is a view of Revelation chapter 4 all over again. All right, just from a different perspective. And Damon put the time clock, so don't worry, I'm not preaching forever. He got time on me. Now a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, a moon under her feet, a head, a garland of 12 stars. Stop right there. Who's the woman? Oh, no. Could be, and I believe it probably is, Israel. Could be church. Could be Eve. Could be lots of different things. Whatever it is, it's probably all of them. Because God is so big, he's bigger than our dinky mindset. I mean, that's the coolest thing about the scripture. It can mean one thing to you today, and the next day you say, well, it's a lot more than what I thought. The moon under feet, on our head, garland of 12 stars. Because why is it 12 stars? Could be the 12 tribes of Israel. Could be the 12 apostles. Could be 12 elders. Who are the 12 elders? Who are the 24? Could be all of them. I don't know. Next verse. And being with child, who would give us the Messiah? Israel. What was the whole promise of Israel? I'll bring from your seed one who will deliver you. Remember what he said to Mary? From you, your seed. Remember the promise from Eve to Eve and the promise that was made to the devil? Being with child, she cried out in labor and pain to give birth. Has there ever been any nation that's ever faced more racism and discriminatory and hatred? And go back and study the history of Israel. Oh, my. And can I tell you, it's not going to stop, because the devil knows where the promise was made, to Abraham and to his seed, and that's you and I. Verse 3. Another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon having 7 heads, 10 horns, 7 diadems on his head. They're probably governments. There's probably rule. Did it represent Rome? Yeah, it probably did. It probably represented Rome and Greece. I'm not even going to go all through those things. It probably was fulfilled, but I guarantee it's going to be fulfilled here in the future. What we do know is this doesn't represent all, because what we do know is the whole world will turn and follow the Antichrist. So it's a representation of different groups. Let's go on. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to earth. Is that probably in the beginning? Could be, yeah. Is it futuristic? Oh, I believe it is, because I'm going to show you something maybe you've never seen before. But how about it be both, because God's bigger than us. Are you guys okay? I know I'm... I hope I'm just expanding you. Again, I'm not telling you what you have to believe. I'm not going to argue with you. Well, it was Rome and Greece. Who cares? And a dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as... You know, that's happened many times. When Moses was going to be born, came after that baby. She had to float him down the river. When Jesus was born, Herod came after that baby. Hello? Think about it. Child, as soon as it was born, verse 5. She bore a male child who was too, and Rodney brought this out, poimen, pastor. The nations with a rod of iron. Her child was caught up to God in his throne. What if we are in Christ, and this is Revelation chapter 4, and we get caught up? What if this is the rapture from a different view? Just throwing it out. What if it represents Israel and she gave birth to Jesus and Jesus was resurrected and Jesus is caught up? He goes to heaven. We know he dies and he's resurrected. All right? To God and his throne. Verse 6. Then the woman fled into the wilderness where a place had been prepared for her. This is what's important here. Provision. There's always provision. There's always provision in God. I am Jehovah Jireh. I am the God who shall supply all of your needs. There's always provision. In your life, there's always provision. If you're really walking with God, you shouldn't have to worry about your house, where you'll sleep, where you'll eat, what you'll do. He said, if I feed the sparrows, I will feed and take care of you. He will provide. A landlord throws you out and you're really walking with God, he'll provide a place for you to go. He's always got provision. Yes, sir. Where they had a place prepared for God that they should feed there 1,260 days. Uh-oh, it seems like that number keeps referencing to what we've been talking about. So when some people say, well, it's only past, well, where's these dates? But watch, we'll keep on walking. Verse 7. And war broke out in heaven. And Michael and his angels fought with the dragon. The Greek is creaky there, is freaky there. It literally says Michael had to fight. It gives the emphasis of how the words are laid out through multiple scholars. And I don't claim to be a Greek scholar. But through multiple scholars will say this wording is so strange that it says Michael was, I mean, all heaven stopped and Michael was forced to show up on the scene. We know Michael shows up in a whole lot of different places. He shows up. Think about this. Where does Michael show up? He show up when Daniel was fighting. Remember Daniel prayed and the angel said to Daniel, don't worry, your prayer's been answered. Michael showed up on the scenes fighting for you. There's another scripture, Jonathan, and we'll put it up in a minute, but I'll let you find it. 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 through, maybe through the end we'll walk through. But let's go on, read through this. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon. Can Jonathan double task because I'm throwing stuff at him? And the dragon and his angels fought. There's war in heaven. See, some people will say, well, this is past. This was the battle. Could be. But I'll tell you, I believe it probably was that, and it's also a reference to what's going to take place here in the soon future. Now, the question I keep asking myself is, I think Rodney said this last week, what caused this war? What caused the devil to freak out right here? Why such a battle? What's the intensity of the battle? Let's go on. Verse 8. But they did not prevail, nor place was found for them. Now, look at this. Nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. Do you catch what that says? The devil no longer will have access to the heavenly realms. The devil lost this battle when Michael came on the scene and fought, and the devil does not have access anymore to the heavenly realms. If this whole verse is about the past, how come we still fight spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places? How's come the devil still works in the spiritual realm? How's come the devil still accuses you and I? The accuser of the brethren. He's still accusing. We're still fighting in the spiritual realm. I don't know what kind of access in the third heaven the devil has before the presence of God. I do know that we get accused, but I do know there's spiritual war. It's very clear. We fight not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, power, spiritual darknesses in the heavenly places. I would tell you that this war breaks out here in the future, such a big battle that now the devil no longer can fight in the spiritual realm. He now is cast to the earth and has to fight an earthly battle. Let's read on, and then I'll explain that, just so you can see that I'm not going crazy. So the great dragon was cast, the serpent of old, the devil, Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. No longer spiritual. My question is, what caused this great war to happen? I believe it's probably the rapture of the church. Why do I say that? Because I think that's when all hell breaks loose. When God takes the Gentiles, the Jews grew stubborn, grew hard, right? Come on. God's not forgotten them. But he goes and grafts in a whole new people of every tribe, tongue, nation, race. Red, black, white, purple, all of us. And when he takes us and pulls us out, the devil knows the time is short. The war is on. As a matter of fact, remember I told you Michael shows up in warring situations? Look at 1 Thessalonians 4, 16. Jonathan, do you have that? And I know I didn't give you that. I apologize. I think that's, I better look at my Bible. I'm throwing verses out on the top of my head. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. Who is the archangel? Who is the archangel? We only know of three of them. Now, if you go read some of the lost books and go read through some Apocrypha, you can come up with some other names, but we only know three that took place in the Bible. Very clear. You have Gabriel, who's the messenger. Lucifer, who fell, and Michael, the warrior. What if Revelation chapter 12, verses 7-8, refer to the rapture of the church takes place, but it took Michael to call us up and bring us forth because the battle was so intense. And as the church is raptured, hell's broke loose. Michael and the angels fight the battle, and from that moment forward, the devil no longer is allowed in the spiritual realm, and has now forced him and his demons on the earth. And you wonder why the earth is going to be so crazy at that time. Wow. Remember, Jesus said to us, I give you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and the enemy, and bind on earth and loose. He gave us authority to fight in the spiritual realm. But there'll be no fight there. Are you okay? I know I'm going a little crazy. This is fun stuff for me. Let's go back to Revelation chapter 12. I only got how many minutes I got? Oh, dear Jesus, Damon's got the clock on me. Revelation chapter 12. Look at verse 10. Did I give you verse 10? I may not have given it to you. And I may not need it. I don't even know where I'm going. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now the salvation, strength, the kingdom of our God and the power of Christ have come, for the accuser of the brethren who was accused before them, our God, day and night, has been cast down again into the earthly realm. Remember I told you hell opens up its mouth and demons come out of the hells that was locked up, Tartarus, different areas of hell. There's going to be such. This is what the Antichrist does. It says he spews out of his mouth philosophies and lies that would deceive. And let me tell you, that's happening to you now. Because you're listening to CNN, you're listening to Fox News, you're listening to CNBC's, and you're listening to all them spew. You know what Facebook is doing to you, right? You know that even both Republican and Democratic congressmen are now looking at Facebook and saying, you guys have tripped this thing. They're causing arguments to start because you only see part of the posts that are put, and they have algorithms that make you believe. And you're just being fed poison. Poison. And you take it in and fight a believer over the poison that was being spewed. You don't even know. Well, I better be careful. I better open my Bible. I got 3 minutes. Jonathan, let's move to Revelation 13 real quick. There are some passages in Revelation 13. I may touch briefly next week of the Antichrist. The Antichrist is going to be scary. The Antichrist is going to be beautiful. Amazing, the most well-spoken, the most peaceful man you've ever met. He's going to cause a peace treaty to take place between the Jews and the Arabs that have never seen. You're going to see him help build a temple. I mean, he's going to come on the scene. Right now, because of the political chaos that's going on, everybody's looking for a political savior who will save them. Welcome, Antichrist. We just set you up. And he's going to spew philosophies and wisdom and it's all worldly and it's all poison and it's all wrong. From our churches everywhere, and everybody's going to like him and everything, everybody's going to love him. And there's some really weird things that happened to him. I may upset you, but I got to say this. I'm going to say it. You know, one place in the scripture in the Old Testament, it says, and he didn't like women. It says he does not have affection towards women. What does that mean? You think what you think about it. Revelation 13 says there'll be such an event happen. The whole world will see it. He's going to be wounded. Is that Rome? Could be. Could be there would be a resurrection. Could be. But I believe it also references a man. What if he's shot in the head? What if they try to assassinate him and we all know it? Wow. Think about it. How many of us don't even remember really the Kennedy days, but we all have seen the stories of the Kennedys being shot? What if that scene happens? The Antichrist is shot. But a few verses later it says, and his wound was healed. We don't even know, and I'm going to help me, Jesus. Maybe, do you know in Thessalonians it says of the Antichrist saying he's going to be such a miracle worker and full of lying wonders. Lying wonders. That means that's why you got to be careful about watching miracles. Be careful about somebody. Miracles come, God's here. Be careful. Be careful. Because the devil can do signs too. And in here, actually, it's going to be in some depth. I'm just wondering even if they don't fake the Antichrist's resurrection. Because lying wonders. Why is it all the world sees him go down and all of a sudden he's back up and everybody sees him and the whole world shouts? There's some scary things coming. Why do I love the book of Revelation? Because you guys got to know how to handle today, let alone how to handle then. The Bible says it's going to be so bad, even the elect would be deceived. Some of you are not reading your word during the week, and then you come in here and just think, well, I'll just come in and listen to Pastor Daner. But that's not going to be enough to handle all the stuff you're going to be going through. And that's why I tell you, don't even believe me. If you see me start saying something crazy, then just, if you don't see it here... I want to close with Revelation 13:10. This is probably one of my most favorite passages. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with a sword must be killed with a sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. I believe this is wisdom for us to live by in the last days. Be careful how you respond to every catastrophe that happens. Be careful how you respond to political riots, racial riots, slavery. Be careful how you respond. Here's what he said. True saints will have patience, will have wisdom, and will have faith. I've watched Christians through our last 6 months act in radical craziness that no way reflects the glory of God. And now listen to me. This is serious. And even the world's looking like the church is doing that. I mean, they hated me. They shot me. I'm shooting back. Oh. If you live by the sword, an old scholar wrote this. It's an intolerable paradox. Hear me out. It's an intolerable paradox to defend the gospel of love by using the violence of men. To be men and women of love and be men and women that are really different, we're going to have to act different. And just because don't respond in anger. Don't respond in hate. Don't respond with violence. Don't respond by you just spewing out your philosophy. You can spew your philosophy, but you'll shut the ear of an unbeliever because they won't hear it anymore. God, may you give us wisdom as we walk in these last days. They're confusing for all of us, God. We're trusting that you know the beginning to the end, that you've been to the end and walked back through it. God, we know that you love us and got a plan for us. We know, God, that things are still lasting because you love the lost. May you give us a vision for the lost. May you give us a heart for the hurting. May God, you today, fill us with the Holy Spirit, a refreshing of the Holy Spirit, that we may have a love that shows the world you're alive. God, I pray for every person in this building today. If you don't know Christ today, I pray you will come to him. I just want you to know he's alive. His arms are open for you today, no matter what you've done. And I want you to know there's going to be a day where the whole world will see him on the throne. And that's what the future looks like. Come to the King today. And maybe you know him and you've grown cold, you've grown weary, you've grown tired, you've just so hurt, you're so wounded, you're so angry. I pray today you will let go of that stuff, because that is of the devil trying to stop you. That's how the devil, he can't get you to turn on God, so he'll just try to get you to become bitter or angry or hate or isolate yourself. I pray today you'll come home. I pray today you will open your heart to the Holy Spirit to help you walk through the hurt, the pain, because remember, every bad thing that happens, God can turn it for the good if you'll allow him to work in your heart today. God, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would move and stir in us. Give these people wisdom. Give them direction as they read through. God, let their eyes be open as they read through your word, as they pray, as they ask you, speak to your children, God. We'll give you the glory and the praise in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Amen. God bless you this morning. Thank you, and we're believing for great things. Wednesday night recap. Remember all the groups going on. We love you. God bless you this morning.